Hello and welcome to The Broken Sword. Today we are looking at the undead-like creatures, the Barrow Wights.
Build me a thorny worthy of Mordor.
He imagined suddenly that he caught a muffled cry, and he made towards it. And even as he went forward, the mist was rolled up and thrust aside, and the starry sky was unveiled. A glance showed him that he was now facing southwards and was on a round hilltop, which he must have climbed from the north. Out of the east, the biting wind was blowing. To his right, there loomed against the westward stars a dark shape. A great barrow stood there. "Where are you?" he cried again, both angry and afraid.
"Here,"
said a voice. Deep and cold, that seemed to come out of the ground.
"I am waiting for you."
"No," said Frodo, but he did not run away. His knees gave and he fell on the ground. Nothing happened, and there was no sound. Trembling, he looked up, in time to see a tall, dark figure like a shadow against the stars. It leaned over him. He thought that there were two eyes, very cold though, lit through a pale light that seemed to come from some remote distance. Then a grip, stronger and colder than iron, seized him. The icy touch froze his bones, and he remembered no more. So first of all, happy Halloween, everybody. You may realize that this is not a usual upload day for us, but giving you something extra on a day like Halloween just seemed like a fun thing to do. And, of course, that means we need to look at something of Tolkien's works that is extra creepy, extra scary. Basically, something that fits Halloween. And that, for us today, are the Barrow Wights. So, get comfortable and come on the journey with me to discover what we can find out about these undead creatures. The Barrow Wights were spirits of pure evil. They were said to appear as a figure of shadow with barely anything but a pale, icy light shining from what should have been their eyes. Their voices were hollow and cold and very deep to match their very cold touch. Definitely something that is fitting for a horror film. These spirits were located in an area of low hills called the Barrow Downs, which was near to the Old Forest, and this is to the east of the Shire and also not far from the village of Bree, all of which we do encounter during the early events of the Fellowship of the Ring. At least in the book, as this was a large section that was cut out of the movie adaptations. And this is the area that Frodo Baggins, along with Sam, Merry and Pippin, were caught and trapped by a wight before the mysterious being Tom Bombadil came to their rescue. In fact, it was from here that the hobbits received their special blades, the daggers of Westeros, of which Merry's would be the one to finally bring down the Witch King of Angmar with. So passed the sword of the Barrow Downs, work of Westeros. But glad would he have been to know its fate who wrought it slowly long ago in the North Kingdom, when the Dúnedain were young, and chief among their foes was the dread realm of Angmar and its sorcerer king. No other blade, not though mightier hands had wielded it, would have dealt that foe a wound so bitter, cleaving the undead flesh, breaking the spell that knit his unseen sinews to his will. It was Tom Bombadil who had found those daggers in the mound that the hobbits were imprisoned in and then saved from. And these daggers were created by the Dúnedain of Cardolan during the time that they were at war against the Witch King of Angmar. And if you aren't sure here, Cardolan was one of the realms of Arnor after Arnor itself had been split from one kingdom into three realms, and these were Arthur Dyne, Rudawer, and Cardolan. But anyway, the daggers that were found are described like the following. For each of the hobbits he chose a dagger, long, leaf-shaped, and keen, of marvellous workmanship, damasked with serpent forms in red and gold. They gleamed as he drew them from their black sheaths, wrought of some strange metal, light and strong, and set with many fiery stones. Whether by some virtue in these sheaths or because of the spell that lay on the mound, the blades seemed untouched by time, unrusted, sharp, glittering in the sun. And also, the war that I just mentioned, being the war against Angmar, was a war that began around the year 1272 of the Third Age and lasted until the year 1409, when the last Prince of Cardolan was laid to rest within the Barrow Downs. Some people even believe that it was the very prince's tomb where the hobbits had become trapped by the Barrow White. After all, as it discusses in the Unfinished Tales book, during the time of the War of the Ring, specifically in the month of September in the year 3018 of the Third Age, is when the Black Riders entered back into these lands while on their hunt for the One Ring. And at this point, their leader, the Witch King, took a trip to the Barrow Downs, and over days took the time to rouse these spirits of the Barrow Whites, as he still possessed knowledge of those lands due to those wars with the Dúnedain all that time ago. And this would be just in time to be able to capture the hobbits on their journey at the end of that very same month, as the Witch King had predicted correctly that the positioning of Bree would be an important one. And I'd actually like to pause here for just a moment to ask you all a quick question. Would you like a video on the wars with Angmar? If so, leave me a comment of "War with Angmar" in the comment section below to show that there is interest. But anyway, this may also make you wonder though, if this land had once been a part of a realm where great men of the Dúnedain had once lived, then how did this then become a place of such evil and terror? Well, quite simply, because of the Witch King. The war between this servant of Sauron and these great men was, well, legendary, and by the end of it, after the Witch King came out as the winner after establishing himself from his great dark fortress of Khan Doom, which was located at the western end of the mountains of Angmar, the Witch King sent out evil spirits to enter into those mounds and dwell there. And this was meant to be as an act of complete disrespect and warning to the Dúnedain. The Whites were sent so that they could haunt the hills of their dead, attempting to prevent any attempts of the Dúnedain to ever try and resettle here again. After all, the idea of burying the greatest dead in these mounds was a tradition that had lived long through the ages, all the way back to the first age of Middle-earth in fact. It is said that the mounds of Tirn Gorthad, as the Barrow Downs were called of old, are very ancient, and that many were built in the days of the old world of the First Age by the forefathers of the Edain, before they crossed the Blue Mountains into Beleriand, of which Lindon is all that now remains. Those hills were therefore revered by the Dúnedain after their return, and there many of their lords and kings were buried. Some say that the mound of which the Ringbearer was imprisoned had been the grave of the last Prince of Cardolan, who fell in the War of 1409. So, looking at all of this, it shows that it was all down to the Witch King as to how these beings came to exist in this area, and this plan was truly successful. After all, when Arthur Dayn had once more claimed the kingship over all of Arnor, the Dúnedain once tried to re-enter these lands and set up a colony again, but due to the Barrow Whites, this was a task that they had to abandon. And now also on a side note here, this may bring up the question with you as well. If the Witch King had this power, did the other 8 of the 9 also possess this ability? Well, to put it simply, it is almost certain that they did not. After all, Sauron, for whatever reason, spent a lot more of his power into the improvement of the Witch King as their Nazgul Lord. Sauron spent countless years pumping more and more knowledge, powers, and abilities to this one being. And this, after all, is why he was so important to the Dark Lord. The Witch King ended up with abilities of sorcery which led him to be able to create weapons just like the Morgul Blade, have an effect on the weather around him, and even be more resistant to the effects of sunlight and water. He very much stood head and shoulders above all of the other 8 Nazgul. Maybe that could be down to the king that he may have once been before he became a wraith, or something else entirely, we will never truly know why. Now, after that little sidetrack though, let's make sure I'm clear. Did the Witch King send the Whites to the Barrow Downs? Yes. Did he create the Whites himself? No. We have to remember that creation and corruption are very much different things in Tolkien's works, and having power over something does not mean you also have the power to create it. Now, I hope I didn't really lose anyone with that and you understand where I'm coming from. And that basically sums everything up for us at this point, in an obviously quite frustrating way. How were the Barrow Whites initially created? Well, technically we do not know. But how did they come to exist in the Barrow Downs? Well, that was due to the devilry of the Witch King of Angmar corrupting some kind of being and sending them down to occupy those graves in those downs. So basically, with a lot of the evil beings of Tolkien's work, it all comes down to corrupting something that was once good into a mockery of that thing as evil. And now to finish off, I'd like to give you all one more quote, and I know this video has perhaps been a little quote heavy, but it has felt more needed for this subject. But this one is from The Lord of the Rings, as it will lead me on to my question for you all today. So, suddenly a song began, a cold murmur rising and falling. The voice seemed far away and immeasurably dreary, sometimes high in the air and thin, sometimes like a low moan from the ground. Out of the formless stream of sad but horrible sounds, strings of words would now and again shape themselves. Grim, hard, cold words, heartless and miserable. The night was railing against the morning, of which it was bereaved, and the cold was cursing the warmth for which it hungered. Frodo was chilled to the marrow. After a while the song became clearer, and with dread in his heart he perceived that it had changed into an incantation. Cold be hand and heart and bone, and cold be sleep under stone. Never more to wake on stony bed, never till the sun fails and the moon is dead. In the black wind the stars shall die, and still on gold here let them lie. Till the Dark Lord lifts his hand over dead sea and withered land. And so, this leads me on to my question for you all today, and that is, from everything that we have heard, as after all it is not known if these evil spirits were anything like perverted beings, like that of evil men, or even maybe something more powerful, but what is your favourite theory as to how these things came to be? After all, from that last quote of their incantation, there must be some, however slight, memory of the warmth, of sunlight and of freedom. So does that hint at some kind of history of a being we may have met in the past? Let me know all of your thoughts, opinions, theories, anything at all in the comment section below. And now, to finish off this Halloween video, it's time to shout out our patrons, with firstly our Divine Power tier members of Kevin, Abram, Matt and Glorfindel of Gondolin. You are all awesome. And a big thanks to our Fire Demon tier members of Nasheeth, Denversteel and Gregory. And as well, I cannot forget the Wizard Staff tier members of John, Andrew and Pirate747. Every single one of you is a true legend of the Brohirrim. Finally, thank you if you have managed to reach the very end of this video with me today. Please remember to do all the stuff like the video, leave a comment on it if you enjoyed it. I hope this extra upload was a fun one for you all, and happy Halloween. So thank you once again, and I will see you next time on The Broken Sword.